Manishma, what's up, Anashim, Mishpaka, family of Yahuwah, hallelujah, Shalom Yehudim, Ma Shalom Ha, and Ma Shalom Ka. I greet you all this Yom to all the Bayit house of Israel, all the Goy, Goyim, coming out of paganism, all the Ger and Garim, feeling alienated, but now being grafted in to the Bayit of Israel. Shalom, Shalim, Shalom Aleichem. Welcome to the Eliyahu channel. Mazel Tov, hallelujah. Remember, hallelujah. We just praise Abba Yah for this opportunity to come before you this Shabbat. This is pre-recorded, so you can, whatever your calendar you use of the timeline of your Shabbat, you can just fit it in and watch it, or have midweek midrash fellowship and study this Parashat Terumah. Hallelujah. The Parashat Terumah. Praise Yah. About the Miqdash, building of the house of Yahuwah, and the heave offering in the beginning of the Perak 25, as we go all the way through to 27. Praise Abba Yah, hallelujah. And remember, of course, we use the phonetic sound charts of the Paleo Semitic Kitav Ibrit. That is the Hebrew Kitab, Semitic Paleo-Hebrew phonetic charts, and we phonetically sound Avinu Abaya, Asher Aya, as Yahuwah, which is Aya Asher Yaya. When you break it down, I am He who breathes Chai. I am He who breathes Chai, Yahuwah. Based on Ayah Asher Ayah, but his name was given in the beginning when man began to call on the Shem of Yahuwah. They knew his name already in the beginning of Bereshit. So now, also, I just want you to come to a revelation of understanding. We do not use an Eliyahu channel. .com and HaRuachEliyahu and ElyahuChannel.com and Eagles Haven Ministry, Eagles Haven 1 and YouTube in the United States. We do not use the Latin Greek harlot daughter offshoot Latin Greek words and language. We stay far from those words. We want nothing to do with those words of the replacement theology, pagan words. We want to stay away from it altogether, and we want to be able to speak and help people get a transition out of the replacement theology, Catholic, Latin, harlot, daughter words that have been introduced to the King Artemis Biblos, the King Artemis Bible. We want to stay away from those Catholic Latin daughter words that are introducing to pagan deities, as well as pagan ritual ceremony words as well. And we want to use more of the Ibrit language for people who can understand, or the cleaner English words. Okay, even the word Bible is Biblos, which means Bella rules. It's the city in Lebanon where Israel used to also be of the jurisdiction. Not now, but in the future, we'll come back to Israel in that area. They named the city Biblos for Bella rules, the goddess Bella, which was in the borderline when you enter the city. Almost like when you come into cities today and you see a wooden sign. The freeways, you don't see it too much, but when you go on the off highways, you'll see signs, welcome to a certain city, and you'll have the different Mason symbols on a big billboard. Welcome to our city. And they'll have their Mason symbols of their pagan deities that they, those principalities that rule in that city. Like you go to Del Soto, Texas, in the four corners of Del Soto, they got obelisks. You go to Frisco, they have huge life-size Washington Monument pillars of obelisks of jealousy images in Frisco, Texas. And Dallas, Texas has got a pyramid, crystal pyramid building also, telling you, letting you know the principality spirits that are operating in those cities. So in the same way, Bella rules, Biblos, all right, is not the word for books and scrolls and paper. Those are different Greek and Hebrew words. People try to clone it and make a transliteration of it, but Biblos is Bella rules. All right. Now, so we don't use those words no more, just to kind of help you with that. So now we're going to go ahead and have a great time and fellowship this Yom of this parashat, the parashat Terumah, and welcome to the Eliyahu channel. Praise Yah. I want to go ahead and give you an agreement, a prayer, eye to eye, right now, so we can pray and agree together. Oh, Abba Yah, Baruch Hashem, Yahuwah Eloheinu, Melech HaOlam. I just pray right now in the Shem of Abba Yah, Yahuwah, that we get praise through Yahuwah, Hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. We give all praise and honor to Him. We stretch our hands and we request Your Neshima, breath of Your Kodesh Ruach, that's in the presence around here with me, that this same Ruach, Neshima breath, will be present in Kodesh anointing in the midst of the people that are watching by live stream or CD, DVD, sound, also by YouTube. We pray for Your presence, Abba, to come upon the people and overwhelm them with Your awesome presence of Your love and the anointing of that Your Shekan Neshima mantle, Your Kodesh Kabad mantle, to be there with them as they watch it too. And they have a little bit of a time like a Shiva, of a time of Midrash together of what we're going to study. We pray for them too, and we ask that the veils will come off and their ears to be open to hear the Kodesh language and even the clean English words, that they may have an understanding and want to come out and come in and be grafted in to the house of Israel. Hallelujah. How many know? Praise Yah. Amen. How many of you know that when we come into those gates, there are going to be 12 gates in New Jerusalem? We wake up from our dirt nap sleep, and we enter into New Jerusalem. There are 12 said giant pearls of gates, one for each tribe. What tribe are you? Not going to be the tribe of the messianic movement of MJA. You're not going to be of any form of that. You're not going to be of the tribe of Christianity. You're not going to be the tribe of any form of the denominations of Christianity and the harlot daughters and all her offshoot denominations, where the 100 and the 50 and the 20, the 5s and the 10s are all different denomination levels according to the budget and the pillars of their steeples with their 1, 2, 3, 5, 6 stack degrees of the Mason religious stack degrees on those the pillar columns of obelisks with that cruce of the secret societies of the Knights of Malta. We're not going to have none of that. It's going to come in. You're going to come into a Hebrew gate of your house, grafted in to the house of Abraham, Ishak, and Jacob, whom is Israel. Come into the Bayit. Let's study now and break the manna and enjoy His Ruach, Neshima breath. Hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. Let's celebrate Parashat Terumah as we go in and begin. We're going to be in Berak, chapter 25, and Pasuk 1 beginning, and we're going to go all the way to Berak 27, to Pasuk 1 through 19. Hallelujah. I'm excited about this Parashat because it's building the whole design of the ark and the tabernacle, which is similar to the body of the house of Israel, the body of the Mashiach, the body of Moshiach, the body of the Mashiach anointing, the body that we are grafted in, and the Ruach is in us, and we are the body of that tabernacle. Hallelujah. He dwells in us. His Ruach, Kodesh Ruach, dwells in us. And Yahuwah spoke to Mosheh, saying, speak to the children of Israel that they take up contribution for me. From everyone whose heart moves him, you shall take up my contribution. And this is the contribution which you take up from them, gold and silver and bronze. Now, this ain't a tithe, right? Which they give the breakdown of the tithe in a different way later. Well, we read a little bit earlier in Torah. But it shows it again in another parashah. But this is the contribution of a free will love offering. Free will love offering. Even when we do this Yom, still, when I go to Israel, I give free will love offerings, and I take my 10% with me, even though I give, even in the States, I give to missionaries and others that are teaching Torah, right rule. I don't give to Christian or Messianics that are teaching all the pagan words. I give to people that are teaching Torah, right rule, and teaching the commandments and the subscribed instructions, all right? So when I go to Israel, I also give contribution special for the feast, as it's post says in Torah, do not come to Peshach empty-handed. So, but right here, this contribution is different. He's telling you what to give. He's giving gold, silver, and bronze, purple, blue, and purple, scarlet material, and fine linen, and goat's hair. Now, you see material italics, it's not in the original Hebrew, but it means scarlet. You throw the word material, hair, goat's hair is not the original Hebrew. It's just goats, and they know already it's the shearing of the goat skin, right? And ram skins dyed red, and fine leather, and acacia wood, verse 6, oil for the light, that's pure virgin oil, white and clear, spices for the anointed oil and for the sweet incense. Shuham stones, and Shuham stones is basically in Hebrew number 7718, green gem onyx, O-N-Y-X, green gem onyx. Stones to be set in the shoulder garment and in the breastplate. So the shoulder garment of the High Kohanim, Zadok Kohan of Aaron's sons, Benai of Aaron, their breastplate and shoulder garments. And they shall make me a Kodesh place, and I shall dwell in their midst according to all that I show you, the pattern of the dwelling place and the pattern of all its furnishings. Make it exactly so. So it must be made exactly to the pattern, right to the pattern, exactly. Okay, now we're going to get to the Ark of the Covenant. Now for the Ark of the Covenant, I'm going to give you a visual picture as we start from verse 10. As we begin, we're going to see all the instruments in the Kodesh place, and the ark is there. You see the ark of the covenant with the cherubims. I got this groupie picture I didn't want to get a close-up. They're all so many different and beautiful, the replicas in gold. But I got this groupie picture because we're going to read about the different instruments, the different artifacts of the Ark of the Testimony, the menorah, the altar of incense, the table of shewbread, the copper altar, and copper brazen. And starting in Pasuk, verse 10, Islam, and it says, and they shall make an ark of Akea wood, 2.5 cubits long, and 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. And you shall overlay it with clean gold, and that is clean, pure gold, inside refined in the fire 7 times, and outside you shall overlay it, and you shall make on it a molding of gold all around. So it's those leaves, and they mold it all around of the acacia wood. Verse 12, and you shall cast 4 rings of gold for it, and put them in its 4 corners, 2 rings on one side and 2 rings on the other side. People design it different because it just says side. It doesn't say the long ways or whatever. So you see people different ways, the way they set up the poles and the rings. Verse 13, and you shall make poles of acacia wood, which is, it's actually shittah wood, because there's multiple plural. So it'd be shittahim wood. All right, Hebrew number 7848, praise Yah. Verse 14, and shall put the poles into the rings on the sides of the ark to lift up the ark by them. The poles are in the rings of the ark. They are not taken from it. And into the ark you shall put the witness which I give you. All right, so in Hebrew it's 57:15 for the word witness, which is the witness of testimony. They say testimony. Testimony is a Latin word. So in Hebrew it is it doeth or odueth. All right, in Latin letters is O-D-U-T-H. I'll show you the screen, 57:15. And you shall make a lid of atonement of clean gold, again, that 7 times refined in the fire, pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide. And you shall make, in verse 18, and you shall make 2 cherubims, or some, in some translation, they, with a K, they say cherubims, of gold, and make them of beaten wood work at beaten work at the 2 ends of the lid of atonement. And that's Hebrew number 37:27, the lid cover, and it's Kapareth 37:27 in Hebrew. Verse 19, and make 1 cherub at 1 end, and the other cherub at the other end. Make the cherubims from the lid of atonement at its 2 ends. Okay, so it's the lid of atonement and Kaporeth 37:27, and verse 20, and the Kaporeth cherubims or kibbuim shall be spreading out their wings above, covering the lid of atonement with their wings and with their faces toward each other, and the faces of the cherubim turn toward the lid of atonement. So their face is to each other, but facing down to the lid of atonement, okay, which you see here in this picture. And you shall put the lid of atonement on top of the ark, and put it into the ark of witness, which I give you. So there's a, you know, the lid is described specifically different than the ark itself, of its construction, what's in it, and what's on it, because that's the place of witness, that's the place of speaking and communicating with Abba Yah, where that ark is. And I shall, verse 22, and I shall meet with you there, and from above the lid of atonement, from between the two cherubim, or cherubim, which are on the ark of the witness, I shall speak to you all that which I command you concerning the children, the Benai of Israel. Okay, so from that place, he's going to communicate specifically. That's the place where the High Kohanim, the sons of the Lord, High Kohanim, communicate with Yahuwah after they do their duties. Verse 23, and you shall make a table of acacia wood, 2 cubic long and 1 cubic wide and 1.5 cubic. And you shall overlay it with clean gold again, and shall make a molten of gold all around it. Okay. And this is for the shewbread, which you see here on the right. The shewbread has its own table with its own post. So does the altar of incense and also the copper altar. Okay. And shall make for it a rim of a hand breadth all around. And that's thick. A hand breadth all around the rim. That's real thick. And shall make a gold molding for the rim all around, and shall make for it 4 rings of gold, and put the rings on the 4 corners that are on its 4 legs, as you see here in the designs in verse 26. And the rings are close to the rim as holders for the poles to lift the table, as you see here in this photograph. And you shall make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold, and the table shall be lifted with them. Verse 29, and this is the table of shewbread. And you shall make its dishes and its ladles and its jars and its bowls for pouring, make them a clean gold. Verse 30, and you shall make the shewbread on the table before me continually. So there's fresh shewbread at all times before the table. Now, I want to show you another photograph here. This is the menorah. I want you to get a vision of the menorah here, because we're about to read the menorah. This is the only thing we're supposed to have spiritually, religiously. Some people have the dalet of the 6-pointed star of Shelomoh that they nickname Star of David. I don't use the word star, because star comes from Ishtara, the pagan goddess. Alright, it's Kokab. So the 6-pointed Kokab of Shelomoh is for political reasons. We use for spiritual reasons only the menorah, not the 9 candlesticks menorah of Hanukkah, which is okay to celebrate, but we want to celebrate with the scriptural accuracy of the 7 points, the 7 candle wick stems, the way it's exactly constructed here in Torah. And the right rule, as you know, as we read, also remember we read it in verse 8, make it according to his furnishing, make it exactly so, the way the pattern Abba Yah gave Mosheh. So let's read verse 31, and you shall make a lampstand of clean gold, that's 7 times in the fire, pure gold, and the lampstand is made of beaten work, its base and its shaft, its cups and its ornaments of knobs and blossoms are from it. As you can see here in this description, as we see show here, the apple fruit, the almond engravements, the apple, which is we're seeing here chapter 25, verse 35, we're about to get to. Also the cup, apple flower, in verse 34, and Numbers of Bar Midbar of 8:4, the base, the cups, the flowers, the lamps, the wicks, the palm breath, and the way it's exactly constructed here. Verse 32, and six branches shall come out of its sides, three branches of the lampstand out of one side, and three branches of the lampstand out of the other side. Verse 33, three cups made like almond flowers on one branch. So you see the three cups here of the almond branches, okay? Three cups made like almond flowers on one branch with ornaments of knob and blossoms. Three cups made like almond flowers on the other branches, as you see here. Praise Abba Yah. With ornament knobs and blossoms. And you can see the knobs with the blossoms. So for the six branches coming out of the lampstands. And on the lampstand itself are four cups made like almond branches. Which you see the four couplings, four cups there in the center branch as well. With ornaments, knobs, and blossoms. Verse 35, and a knob under the four, two branches of the same. So you got the four count, and you got the knob under the four, two branches, the same in the center, and the count. Very, very nice drawing here, pictorial image. Verse 35, and a knob under the first two branches of the same, and a knob under the second two branches of the same, and a knob under the third two branches of the same, according to the six branches coming out of the lampstands. The knob, their knobs, and their branches are the same, all of it one beaten work of clean, pure gold, seven times in the fire. And you shall make seven lamps for it, and they shall mount its lamps so that they give light in front of it. And its snuffers and their trays are of clean gold. And it is made of a talent of clean gold with all these utensils. Okay. So see and do according to the pattern which was shown to you on the mountain. So Mosheh, he got a pattern of what was in Shamayim. The tent of witness is now going to phase out into the tent, the tabernacle, where the ark of the lid goes with the two messengers on top of the atonement of what we call the place of the testimony. The witness of testimony now is where the communication is being done. Okay, so this is transferred, still a tent of witness, but it's right there in with the ark now. Okay, and the pattern has to be the way it is in Shamayim on earth, because this is the shadow of the image of Shamayim to the Eretz. Okay, so it shows a great description there of what we were looking at, of those furnituring, of all, which, you know, the copper basin, we're going to get to the copper altar, things like that. But we're going to go ahead now to of the details of the curtains and the colors and the different beautiful images that are there. You notice that we can make an image for the eternal part of the ark, of the tent, all right, the tabernacle, but you cannot make images of messengers outside of it. It's only for the Kohan visuals, because they don't want you to have people to start to worship those images. And the Kohan are trained enough, they're not going to make an idol of it and worship toward it. All right? Inside where the tabernacle, they don't worship. They lift their hands and their head high when they do the praise and worship and prayer. They don't face these messengers like they're worshiping angels. Like we use the word of messengers or malaks or malakim. Okay? And we're going to Berek chapter 26 now. Okay? For the curtains of the ark, inside, outside, the inner Kodesh Kodeshes, Kodeshim, Kodesh Kodeshim place, as well all the different colors and designs. Verse 1. And make the dwelling place with 10 curtains of fine woven linen and purple and, linen and blue and purple and scarlet material. Make them with the cherubims or the cherubims, the malakim, all right, the work of a skilled workman. And the length of each curtain is 28 cubits, and the width of each curtain 4 cubits, all the curtains having one measure. 5 curtains are joined to each other, 5 curtains are joined to each other. Okay, so 5 are joined to each other and 5 are joined to each other. And you, verse 4, shall make loops of blue on the edge of the end of the curtain on one side set, and do the same on the edge of the end curtain of the second set. Make 50 loops in the one curtain, and make 50 loops on the edge of the end curtain of the second set, the loops being opposite to each other. As you can see, the loops and the curtains and the connectors and the rings and the poles in the image of the pillars and columns of wood here, as well as the layers of curtains. Verse 5, make 50 loops in the one curtain, and make 50 loops on the edge of the end curtain of the second set, the loops being opposite to each other. And you shall, verse 6, and you shall make 50 hooks of gold, and shall join the curtains together with the hooks, and the dwelling place shall be one. And you shall make curtains of goat's hair for a tent over the dwelling place. Make 11 curtains, 11 layers. Wow. Verse 8, the length of each curtain is 30 cubits, and the width of each curtain 4 cubits, one measure to the 11 curtains. And you shall join the 5 curtains by themselves, and the 6 curtains by themselves, and you shall double over the 6 curtains at the front of the tent. Verse 10, and you shall make 50 loops on the edge of the curtain that is outermost in one set, 50 loops on the edge of the curtain and of the second set. Verse 11, and you shall make 50 bronze hooks, and put the hooks into the loops, and join the tent together, and it shall be one. Verse 12, and the overlapping part of the rest of the curtains of the tent, the half curtain that remains, shall have hang over the back of the dwelling place, as you see here in the description in the picture. Verse 13, and a cubit and one side, and a cubit on the other side of what remains of the length of the curtain of the tent is to hang over the sides of the dwelling place. Oh, it looks so beautiful. It looks so beautiful. And this is, actually, you can fit this over Israel, Jerusalem. You can fit this, you can fit a man's human body over it, and you have the different parts, the heart, the organs, everything as well. So This is a very Kodesh thing of what is in Shamayim that's given to us in advance of that image. And verse 14, and you shall make a covering of ram skin dyed red for the tent, and a covering of fine leather above that. And the fine leather is, of course, the goat skin. That is a form of a leather. And for the dwelling place, you shall make the boards of acacia wood standing up. So now we're going to go into the board and the beams of the wood. First, that was all the poles, the rings, the hooks, and the curtains. Now we're going to read about what we see here, the different poles and boards. Verse 16, 10 cubits is the length of a board, and a cubit and a half the width of each board. 2 tenons in each board for binding one to another. Do the same for all the boards of the dwelling place, as you see here. And you shall make the boards for the dwelling place, 20 boards for the south side, and make 40 sockets of silver under the 20 boards, 2 sockets under each of the boards of its 2 tenons. Verse 20, and for the second side of the dwelling place on the north side, 20 boards, and there 40 sockets of silver, 2 sockets under each of the boards. Verse 22, and for the extreme parts of the dwelling place westward, make 6 boards, and make 2 boards for the 2 back corners of the dwelling place, and they are double beneath the similarity. They are complete to the top, to the one ring, so it is for both of them. They are for the 2 corners, and they shall be 8 boards, and their sockets of silver, 16 sockets, 2 sockets under the one board, and 2 sockets under the other board. And you shall make bars of acacia wood for the 5 for the boards on one side of the dwelling place, and 5 bars for the boards on the other side of the dwelling place. Praise Abba Yah. Hallelujah. 5 bars for the boards of the side of the dwelling places, and for the extreme parts westward. 28, with the middle bar in the midst of the boards going through one end to end. Verse 29, and overlay the boards with gold, make their rings of gold as holders for the bars, and overlay the bars with gold. 30, and you shall rise, and you shall raise up the dwelling place according to its pattern which you were shown on the mountain. Verse 31, and you shall make a veil of blue and purple scarlet material, as you see here in this description, and the fine woven linen, the work of a skilled workman, made with cherubims, and you, verse 32, and you shall put it on the 4 columns of acacia wood, scarlet with gold, their hooks of gold upon 4 sockets of silver. Okay, and you shall hang the veil from the hooks, and shall make, and shall bring the ark of witness there behind the veil, and the veil shall make a separation for you between the Kodesh place and the Kodesh Kodeshim place. and you shall put the lid of atonement upon the ark of the witness in the most Kodesh Kodeshim place. And you shall set the table outside the veil and the lampstand opposite the table on the side of the dwelling place toward the south, and put the table on the north side. Now, before we continue in verse 36, I want you to get a visual of this. The Kodesh curtain, it shows it divided here as a cutout so you can see inside the tabernacle, the tent, all right? The Sukkot of Yahuwah, the Bahit, house of Yahuwah. Now, the curtain, the veil that divided between the Kodesh place and the Kodesh Kodeshim place, right? We don't use the pagan harlot daughter word, holy, holy, holy place, holy, holy, because that is a spirit. That is a description of a Greek presence of the halo, holy, 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 halo, on top of the head of the pagan Catholic idols of their santos, all right? Or the Greeks have these halo with these rays of light on it too, like the statue of the goddess Libertarius or Dykish Libertarius or others, or even the one of Columbiana on top of the Capitol building in D.C., District of the Columbiana, right? We don't use that word. We use Kodesh Kodeshim, all right? Because that's a description of the pagan deities, holy of holy. We use Kodesh Kodeshim, right? So now, as you're looking at this curtain was so veil was so heavy and thick. Now listen to me, people. There was no dividing post in the middle. It was one person, one post, and one veil. They didn't lift it up. They did not lift the veil up to let the Kohan crawl in or get in. It was too heavy to carry for one or two men to lift it up from the bottom. This thing was hand breadths thick, thick, woven at gold. It had all these beautiful linen, heavy wool, all this heavy material, all right? So how did the Kohan get to the Kodesh Kodeshim place? When he's burning the incense, he lights the shoe, he has the shewbread, he has the candlesticks burning. The sweet incense is thrown on the incense altar you see there before the curtain. Then he goes through the curtain. He starts to worship Abba Yah. He starts to proclaim and declare Yahuwah Shem. He starts, Yah be praised. Yahuwah, hallelujah, Yah be praised. He starts worshiping. Then the Kabod presence comes in. The Shekinah presence. That's right. Don't use that word, Shekinah. That's a pagan deity. You learned that before. You can go on my website and learn the different words. I have a video, who are the Shekinah and Al-Ilah and Yahweh. Who are these names? What they mean? All right. Shekinah is the same word for the goddess Gloria, for the where the Kabbalists use for the wife of Yahweh. All right. We don't use those pagan words. All right. In Hebrew, in the scripture, the word in throughout Torah, Shekinah does not exist in the Tanakh. It's Shekinah and Kabod, the weight of his presence in Hebrew. Nobody goes out and look it up in Hebrew to see Kabod or the Shekinah presence. All right. So now, why the presence of his esteem, you got to realize, as the burning incense, the pillar of fire by Yom is above the tabernacle, and the pillar of the cloud, the kabod, the shekan, is on the tabernacle, and it does not burn. All right? But you see the image, which I've been in a tent meeting, and I've seen the kabod presence and the pillar of fire above and the cloud in the inside, the kabod shekan, thick layer. Now when the presence is in there, he is prompted by the Ruach to go through the veil. He goes through the veil. All right? Now, when Yahushua was slaughtered and his blood was put on the horns of the altar, and supernaturally what's in the Shamayim and what's on the Eretz shall take place, and he goes through the veil. That's why the veil was cut in many pieces from the top bottom, because you can't cut it sideways, right? It's too thick. It took a malakim to tear it from the top to the bottom. Like certain material, you try to tear it sideways, it won't tear. You got to catch the sewing beginning point and tear it from the end point, and it tears easier, but you can't tear it the other way. So it's ripped from the top to the bottom. The tent of the witness is like our lab. He comes into our lab, but in order to come to our lab, he must come through the door, the veil. And the only way to come into the veil, to get into your heart, you begin to worship, and the presence of the neshima, breath of the Kodesh Ruach comes upon you, and the presence of the Ruach comes inside through the veil of your flesh into your heart, into your lap, and he comes inside and dwells within you, your nefesh, into your lap, and your whole tabernacle is constructed like the body of a man or woman of the house of Israel. So the High Kohanim, when he's burning the incense and the presence of the Shekan mist comes in, and he walks through the veil. He translates through the veil inside. Now, if he's not Kodesh, hello, how could he get in anyways? But if he sins inside for whatever in his nefesh, in his mind, and falls down, they put a rope with a bell. The bells were in the bottom of their clothing, which you'll see later the images I'm going to show you. When he's burning incense, when he's doing the work inside, I have pictures for you. I'll show you. If he falls out, he's stricken by the Malak that goes ahead of us, and we hear his voice in that ark, okay? The tent of witness, it says, as we read in the last parashat, to obey his voice, follow him, and guard his word and his voice. If you go in, if that Kohan goes in and he's not right and falls out, several of the Kohan have to lift up the curtain, and they pull by the rope where the bell to his ankle, and they pull him out. Okay? And somebody else has to go in, Kodesh and Kodeshim, Zadok, Talmudim, Kohan, to go in and perform the duty. And this gives the reverence that the Kohan has to have: clean thoughts, a clean lab, clean surroundings. Now the atmosphere is full of the presence of the Ruach HaKodesh. So how could you even allow wicked, impure thoughts in? If you're a high Kohani and you never had committed adultery and fornicate and committed wicked thoughts, those images and pictures can't come in. If you never had pictures and images of unclean thoughts like we have in the atmosphere of us in this yom and age, okay, then those images are not there for HaShatan to spark thoughts and fiery darts of Mastema, the accuser of the brethren, to put those images to blemish your thoughts in your nefesh, in your heart. Okay? They're not there because you're a Kohan. You never had those acts of evil, all right? Of sin. You're walking Kodesh Kodeshim, a Zadik, Kohan, right? So this image is the enemy can't pull it up in a fiery dart and shoot in your brain, bring the pictures, because you never had those pictures. You never tasted strong drink and seen women dance nude and all those things to your battle in the mind to take place, because your nefesh and your lap is pure and clean. You have virgin minds. Okay, the only images you have is your own spouse, your own wife, and you're under the presence of Yahuwah and the Ruach. You're not allowing those thoughts in. So you're worshiping and going through the veil to do His duty. Praise Abba Yah. And the same thing when we worship, and His Neshima, breath of the Kodesh Ruach of Yahuwah, comes upon us. Ooh, I feel His presence of His anointing upon me in the room, and I pray right now in the studio to go out to you, His presence of His Ruach Kodesh, and He dwells within us, and that curtain is our flesh barrier protection of the breastplate of righteousness there. And He comes in willingly, freely, because we open our heart to let the Ruach in to us. And likewise, we go in to the Kodesh Kodeshim place. Abba Yah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Verse 36. And you shall make a covering for the door of the tent of blue and purple and scarlet material and fine woven linen made by a weaver. You see right here in the front. Now this is a curtain of a door. And you shall make for the covering five columns of acacia wood. Okay? And overlay them with gold, their hooks of gold, and you shall cast five sockets of bronze for them. So there's five curtains here. 1, 2, 3. And there's another one you can see on the right side on the base. 4, 5. Five of those poles or columns. Okay? Praise Abba Yah. Now, we're going to go back. We got the visual here. Now we're going to get another picture and go to Berak, chapter 27, Pasuk 1. As you see in this picture here, here's the Kodesh place instruments and the Kodesh Kodeshim instruments as well. And you see the High Kohanim, the son Benai of Aaron, the Zadok Kohanim, and he has little fringes, and he has bells also. The breastplate, his girdle, his shoulder garments, all these things that are here taking place as well. As a visualization, you can see that as well. Okay? Here, we're going to look at this outward vision. We're going to get some closer pictures in a while, but let me continue to read in Perek chapter 27, Pasuk verse 1. And you shall make a slaughtering place of acacia wood, 5 cubits long, 5 cubits wide. The slaughter place is square, and its height 3 cubits. Verse 2. And you shall make its horns on its four corners. Its horns are of the same, and you shall overlay it with bronze. And you shall make its poles to receive its ashes, and its shovels, and its basins, and its forks, and its fire holders. Make all its utensils of bronze. And you shall make, verse 4, and you shall make a grating for it, a bronze network, and shall make on the network 4 bronze rings at its 4 corners, and shall put it under the rim of the slaughtering place beneath, so that the network is halfway up the slaughtering place. Verse 6, and you shall make poles for the slaughtering place, poles of acacia wood, and shall overlay them with bronze. and the poles shall be put in the rings, and the poles shall be on the two sides of the slaughtering place for lifting up. So you can see that here as well, this picture of the altar, okay? And it has the four corner horns, you got the poles and the rings, as you see here as a vision. Verse 8, and make it hollow with boards as it was shown to you on the mountain. Now let's look at the courtyard again a little better here. And you shall make the courtyard, verse 9, of the dwelling place for the south side, screens for the courtyard made of fine woven linen, 100 cubits long for one side, and its 20 columns and their 20 sockets of bronze, the hooks of the columns and their bands of silver. Verse 11, and so for the north side in length screens, you should 100 cubits long with its 20 columns and their 20 sockets of bronze, and the hooks of the columns and their bands of silver, and the width of the courtyard on the west side, screens of 50 cubits with their 10 columns and their 10 sockets. Okay? So here's another little visual on Parashat Terumah, okay? Verse 13, and the width of the courtyard on the east side, 50 cubits, and the screens on one side of the gate, 15 cubits, with their three columns and their three sockets, and on the other side, screens of 15 cubits, and the three columns, their three sockets. You can see vaguely here by a distance the different rings and sockets and descriptions here. And for the gate of the courtyard, covering 20 cubits long of blue and purple and scarlet material and the fine woven linen made by a weaver, four columns and four sockets. All the columns around the courtyard have bands of silver, their hooks silver, and their sockets bronze. Praise Yah, hallelujah. Here's another visual. You can look at it a little bit. The length, verse 18, the length of the courtyard is of 100 cubits, and the width 50 by 50. The width 50 by 50, and the height 5 cubits, woven of fine linen thread, and its sockets of bronze. We don't have a close-up in this picture, but kind of gives you a visual. All the utensils of the dwelling place for all its service, all its pegs, and all its pegs of the courtyard are of bronze. Verse 20, and you are to command for the children of Israel to bring you clear oil of pressed olive for the light to cause the lamp to burn continually. In the tent of appointment outside the veil, which is before the witness, Aaron and his sons are to tend it from evening until morning before Yahuwah, a Torah right rule forever to their generations, from the children, the Benai of Israel. Hallelujah, Parashat Terumah, hallelujah, praise Abba Yah. Powerful, powerful pictures, images, and revelation of this parashat, of what we visualize as we see here a little bit. This is not a close-up, but kind of to give you the image and the pictures of this revelation. Okay. Now here's another image of a distance with the Kabod, what we call the Shekan Kabod anointing pillar of cloud during the Yom. And of course, we have, you've seen the visuals of the pillar of fire at night. Laila. Praise Abba Yah, hallelujah. And this is how they were set up in their divisions of their tribes all around. Praise Abba Yah. So this is fantastic, powerful. We have time to continue on. We want to continue on in the parashat, but to do the haftarah in Melech Aleph, chapter 5, Perak 5, and Perak 6. So let's go now to Esort. And let's continue the parashat and look at the description of this parashat of the haftarah of the Terumah concerning the Bayit House of Shelomoh. Hallelujah. So let's continue now. Verse 1. And Hiram, sovereign of Soroah, sent his servants to Shelomoh because he heard that they had anointed him. They had Mashach, Mashiachim, anointing, type of anointing him, sovereign in place of his Abba Yah, of his Abba. For Hiram had always loved David. And this word is Mashach, for this word of anointing. If I were to go here to this place, anoint, it's for, it's Mashach. Okay, this is the first anointing stage before Mashiach. All right, the third anointing is Mashiach. And Shelomoh did receive all three. He received the Mashiach, the Mashiach, and the Mashiach. Remember, Yahushua is a High Kohanim, same like in Zechariah, who received three anointings plus the other Koini Zadok anointings, which is about four or five anointings total. Okay, so Mashach, Mashiach, Mashiach, and also the Kohan has another type of anointings with a different sweet smell of that oil too. And Shelomoh sent to Hiram saying, you know my father, Abba David, was unable to build a house for the Shem of Yahuwah, his Aloha, because of the battles which were all around him, until Yahuwah put them under the soles of his feet. But now, Yahuwah, my Aloha, has given me rest all around, and there is neither adversary nor evil incident, not even crimes of evil incidents. Everything's clean and pure. And see, I intend to build a house for the name, the Shem of Yahuwah, my Aloha. So Abba had all the borders clean and pure of any incidents and even crimes in the Kodesh place of Jerusalem as well. Might have been stuff in the outskirts, but not in Jerusalem and not in Jerusalem, nor not in the Kodesh place area. Verse 5, and see, I intend to build a house for the Shem of Yahuwah, my Aloha, as Yahuwah spoke to my Abba David, saying, your son, whom I set on your throne in your place, he does build the Bayit for my Shem. Verse 6, and now command that they cut down cedars for me from Lebanon, and let my servants be with your servants, and let me pay your wages for your servants according to whatever you say. For you know there is none among us who knows to cut timber like the Zidonians. Verse 7. And it came to be when Hiram heard the words of Shelomoh that he simka greatly and said, Baruch be Yahuwah this Yom, for he has given David a chakma by bina Hakma Da'at, son over this great people. And Hiram sent to Shelomoh, saying, I have heard that which you sent me. Let me do all you desire concerning the cedar and cypress logs. Verse 9, let my servants bring them down from Lebanon to the sea. Then I put them in rafts by sea to the place you direct me, and I shall spread them out there. Then you take them up while you do my desire by giving food for my household. Verse 10, and Hiram gave Shelomoh cedar and cypress logs, all his desires, and Shelomoh gave Hiram 20,000 gores of wheat as food for his household, 20 gores of pressed oil. Thus Shelomoh gave to Hiram year by year. And Yahuwah gave Shelomoh Chokmah, as he promised him, and there was shalom between Hiram and Shelomoh, and the two of them made a covenant. They made a covenant. Now let's look at here. This is 24:51. It's not wisdom, it's Chokmah. He gave him Chokmah. Hallelujah, which is Chokmah Da'av, is knowledge obtained through education in school. That's Da'av. Chokmah is by the Ruach Kodosh with a mixture of spiritual education and understanding. But Ba'nab comes straight from Shamayim. Here is 24:51 in Hebrew. Chokmah. Hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. They made a covenant, an agreement. Sovereign Shelomoh raised up compulsory labor out of all Israel. And the compulsory labor was 30,000 men. So they had, like you go to a National Guard, you had to pull your 30 days in, your 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks in. You had like a National Guard. They had to pull in their tax labor of compulsory labor. They get money for food and raiment and everything they need for their household as they're out there, but it's a low wages to keep their household going, and they would rotate, as we see here from verse 13 on. And Shelomoh raised up, verse 14, and he sent them to Lebanon, 10,000 a month by course. They were 1 month in Lebanon, 2 months at home, and Adonai Ram was over compulsory labor. That's the name of the man, Adonai Ram. All right. So he was the chief master, Adonai Ram. Here comes the chief superintendent. He becomes the chief boss of all. 15. Okay. Shelomoh had 70,000 bearing burdens, 80,000 cutting stone in the mountains, besides 3,300 from the chiefs of Shelomoh deputies who were over the work, those ruling over the people who labored in the work. And the sovereign commanded, and they brought large stones, precious stones, to lay the foundation of the Bayit HaGogal, house of Yahuwah, with cut stones, prefab cut already in advance. Verse 18, Shelomoh's builders and Hiram's builders and the men of Gibal did cut and prepared timber and stones to build the house. Hallelujah, the Bayit. And it came to be in the 480th year after the children of Israel had come out of the land of Mizraim, in the fourth year of the reign of Shelomoh over Israel, in the mount of Zah, which is the second month that he began to build the house, the Bayit of Yahuwah. They say the month of Ziv, but we know that the month of Ziv, the real word is HaShini Kodesh. It's the Kodesh HaShani, right? That means the second, the word like 2ED, second. It is not the number of Stayim, which is the number. It is the second, like a number 2 with an ED on. We say second, and that is HaShini Kodesh. Ziv or Zu is actually a pagan deity, so we don't use that word for the pagan rabbinical calendar today. I think it's like 10 of their, or 9 or 8, I don't got it in front of me, their pagan call, the names of their Kodesh of their month are pagan deities. So it's actually HaShini Kodesh. Verse 2, and the house, Mayit, which the sovereign Shelomoh built for Yahuwah, was 60 cubits long and 20 wide and 30 cubits high. Wow. And the porch at the front of the Heykel of the house was 20 cubits long according to the breadth of the house, and its width 10 cubits from the front of the house, which you see here. I have pictures. Verse 3, and the porch at the front of the Heykel of the Bayit of the house, the Heykel, the big Bayit of Yahuwah, house is Bayit, Heykel is big house, was 20 cubits long. Isn't it a trip that some tribes of the Native Americans have their place, spiritual place, called the big house? And this is Heykel, Heykel Bayit of Yahuwah, big house, all right, was 20 cubits long according to the breadth of the Bayit, and is width 10 cubits from the front of the Bayit. Verse 4, and he made for the house windows with narrowed frames. Verse 5, against the wall of the Bayit, he built rooms all around, against the walls of the house, all around the Heykel and the speaking place. This is the, like, they call pulpits today, but it's the speaking place, the tent of witness, the speaking place. Thus, he made side rooms all around. Verse 6, the lowest side room was 5 cubits wide, and the middle one was 6 cubits wide, and the third was 7 cubits wide. For he made narrow ledges around the outside of the house, so as not to lay hold on the walls of the house. And the house, when it was being built, was built with finished stone made ready beforehand, so that no hammer or chisel or any iron tool was heard in the house while it was being built. Verse 8, and the doorway for the middle side rooms was on the right side of the house, and they went up by stairs to the middle side rooms, and from the middle to the third. So he built the house and completed it, and he paneled the house with beams and boards of cedar, and he built the side rooms of the structure against the house, each 5 cubits high. And they were fastened to the house with cedar beams. And the word of Yahuwah came to Shelomoh, saying, this house which you are building, if you walk in my Torah, right rule, prescribed instructions and do my right rulings and shall guard all my commands and walk in my precepts, hallelujah, and walk in them, then I shall confirm my word with you, which I spoken to your Abba David, hallelujah. Verse 13, and shall dwell in the midst of the children, the Benai Israel, and not forsake my Anashim Israel, Ha'am Anashim Israel. Praise Abba Yah. Praise. He won't forsake it if we keep the right rule. And that's the reason why things are happening in Israel under attacks of terrorists, Islamic terrorists, consistently, because there are certain kinks, cracks in the shield of the protection of the covenant, because they're allowing the Sodomites and the Gomorrahites and the little spirits called Zora and Zobaim and Ma and Gomorrah and Saddam, all these spirits that were destroyed with Sodom and Gomorrah are coming into the walls of Jerusalem and into the area of Jerusalem. And Abba has allowed the kinks in the cracks in the armor to be persecuted upon them. They may repent of their sins, but if you keep the covenant right rule, and also the pagan idols in plain sight in the Jerusalem temple, which I have a video on that as well, allows the kinks in the armor and the enemy to come in. And then the parallel truth comes in. If they keep the Torah and guard it, he'll guard and protect us. If we don't, then he'll forsake the people of Israel. But if you do, then he will not forsake the people of Israel. Hallelujah. Verse 14. So Shelomoh built the house and completed it, and he built the walls of the house inside with cedar boards from the floor of the bayit to the ceiling. He paneled them on the side with wood and covered the floor of the house with planks and cedars. Verse 16. And he built 20 cubits at the rear of the bayit from the floor to the walls with cedar boards, and he built it inside as the speaking place, as the most Kodesh Kodeshim place. 17. And the house bayit was 40 cubits. It is the Heykel before it, and the cedar for the bayit inside was carved with ornaments and open flowers. All was cedar, not a stone was seen. So the cedar, you got Jerusalem stone in the outside, but inside was thick, beautiful wood. Verse 19, and he prepared the speaking place in the midst of the Mahit house to place the Ark of the Covenant of Yahuwah there. Verse 20, and the front of the speaking place was 20 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, 20 cubits high, and he overlaid it with refined gold and overlaid it, the altar, with cedar. And Shelomoh overlaid the inside of the bayit with refined gold and made the gold chains pass over the front of the speaking place, overlaid it with gold. Verse 22, thus he overlaid the entire house with gold until the entire house was completed and the entire altar that was by the speaking place he overlaid with gold. And inside the speaking place he made two cherubim of olive wood, 10 cubits high. And one wing of the cherub was 5 cubits, and the other wing of the cherub 5 cubits, 10 cubits from the tip of the wing to the tip of the other. And the other cherub was 10 cubits. Both cherubim were of the same size and shape. The height of the cherub was 10 cubits, and so was the other cherub. And he placed the cherubim in the midst of the inner house, and they stretched out the wings of the cherub so that the wings of the one touched one wall, and the wing of the other cherub touched the other wall, and their wings touched each other in the middle of the room. And he overlaid the cherub with gold, and he carved all the walls of the house all around, both inside and outside, with carved figures of cherubim and palm trees and open flowers. And he overlaid the floor of the house with gold inside and outside, and for the entrance of the speaking place he made doors of olive wood and lintels of doorpost. A fifth, verse 32, and the two doors were of olive wood, and he carved on them figures of cherubims and palm trees and open flowers, and overlaid them with gold, and he spread the gold on the cherubim and on the palm trees. Verse 33, and so he made the doorpost for the door on the hekel of olive wood, and a fourth part. Verse 34, and the doorpost and the two doors were of cypress wood, and the two leaves of the one folded, and two leaves of the other door folded. And he carved cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers, and overlaid them with gold laid smoothly on the carved work. This is only found to make an image of the cherubims of the cherubs in the Kodesh place, in the altar, in the Bayit house of Yahuwah. We're not to make images of anything in Shamayim, or the Eretz, or under the Eretz, or under the sea, and have it around our houses, these certain things that people end up worshiping. Okay? These are only found in the house of Yahuwah. Verse 36, and he built the inner courtyard with three rows of cut stone and a row of cedar beams. Verse 37, in the fourth year, the foundation of the house of Yahuwah was laid, Kodesh month, and in the 11th year, in the fourth month, which is, of course, it's not Bull. Bull is a pagan deity. The 8th month, the 8th also, Hashini, Kodesh, the 8th month, okay, the house was completed in all its matters according to all its plans. Thus he built it for 7 years. So the house of Yahuwah, without making a noise, hammer, everything was fit in place, perfectly slotted in, built outside the city and brought in. So this is the Kodesh completion of the comparison. And I got pictures there for you in comparison of the Kodesh Kodeshim place of the tabernacle in the wilderness onto Jerusalem to the place of also of Shelomoh, the first Bayit house of Yahuwah. Hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. We give praise and honor. There's over 70 unclean words in your scriptures, in the Ketubim and the Tanakh, as well the Ketubim Bet, so the Brit Kedasha. So you can get my pamphlet, and that would get you started. You can email me at eagleshavenministry@yahoo.com, or you can also email me, or go to our website at eagleshavenministry.com and go to our website and see some of the PDF file of the correct words there. Or I can send you PDF files, email you PDF files that you can put on the screen with PowerPoint and teach others. Or you can request also the printed copy. I'll do both for you as well. It doesn't matter. You can request to email me and send me your full name and address, or you can email me and I will send you PDF files and send you email PDF files and send you the hard copies through the mail. Praise Abba Yah. Well, praise Abba Yah. That was a powerful teaching concerning the nefesh and the lab of our and the veil, to press through the veil, through worship, entering into that veil, into the Kodesh, and then outer court, from the outer court to the outer court, to the inner court, into the inner place, and the inner place of the Kodesh Kodeshim, house of Yahuwah. Hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. Showing the description and the places. Praise Abba Yah. Isn't that wonderful? And so go ahead and email me, as you see right here on the screen. Go ahead and email me. You can write me as well, or email me. You can also go to EagleshavenMinistry.com if you'd like to give us a donation with a check. Or you can go to EagleshavenMinistry.com and see on the lower left side a PayPal where you can give a gift through the card. Or you can mail me through Eagleshaven Ministry at P.O. Box 262403. Plano, Texas, 75026. Praise Abba Yah. Thank you for joining us. I midrash on that. Watch it again. Look at the description. Look at Google Images. Find more images of the building and the construction of the tabernacle and the instruments. Okay? For the sake of time, I didn't get a chance to put it all in there in detail. But I pray Yahuwah to baruch you, and may his Berekat and Berekot from Shamayim pour down on you and fill you with his Baruch and Berekah in the Shem of Yahuwah, Abba Yah. Yahuwah, thank you, Abba Yah, and Baruch your people. Braki Yah, hallelujah. Praise Abba Yah. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you for watching us. Thank you for joining us. And be Baruch.